Thank you. this morning as we gather together for worship. At the outset of this service, we've got clearly quite a number of visitors with us, and a few of our own folks who are not so well with any colds and various other things. I really don't want to disturb some kind of strangely dressed visitors down the front, if you haven't noticed. I don't want to kind of upset the costumes too much, but we might want to take a moment just to meet and greet one another and to welcome one another. And if the folks at the front want to stay there because you don't want to get kind of crumpled or upset or something, then that's absolutely fine. Let's take a moment to greet and welcome one another, shall we? Take just a moment to explain what is going to take place this morning. This morning we have a Christmas family service, therefore, that being the case, where we would regularly have communion in the morning, that will happen this evening rather than this morning. And a lot of what we have this morning will centre around Simeon the musical. Our presentation that will come to us from Sunday school and Bible class, together with various leaders, parents and friends. So we look forward to that presentation, which will occur shortly. We'll also join together in singing some carols, and rather, from my point of view, than having, as it were, a kind of sermon, we will have several comments linked together that will be centred around the hymns and the readings that we have, and indeed commenting briefly on the story of Simeon himself. Let us hear then from the New Testament, from the Gospel of Luke, something of the story of Simeon before we go any further and before we celebrate in song in a well-known carol. Just after Jesus was born, he was taken to the temple. And that is the scene that is at the heart of the presentation this morning. And so we hear that from the Gospel of Luke. On the eighth day, when it was time to circumcise him, he was named Jesus, the name the angel had given him before he had been circumcised. When the time of their purification, according to the law of Moses, had been completed, Joseph and Mary took him to Jerusalem to present to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every firstborn male is to be consecrated to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice in keeping with what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required. Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people Israel." The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him. Then Simeon blessed them and said to Mary his mother, "This child is destined to cause the falling and rising of many in Israel, and to be a sign that will be spoken against, so that the thoughts of many hearts will be revealed. The sword will pierce your own soul too." Amen. Having heard then of the coming of Christ, of his birth and him being presented at the temple, we join together in song in the well-known carol, Mission Praise number 47, A Wave in a Manger. We stand together and sing number 47. Simeon, his steadfast hope, warding off old men's fears, came again to the temple and saw hope for the world in the eyes of a child. Found peace for himself in the dependence of a baby, knew he held God in his hands, and that he and all things are in the hands of God. This time. opportunity to say thank you that you sent your only begotten Son as a vulnerable little baby into a hostile world. We say thank you for that. Thank you for the wonder of it. Thank you for the opportunity to celebrate. Thank you for what it means to so many in terms of family celebrations and partying and festivities and so on. We say thank you for all of that. But most of all, we say thank you for Jesus. This Christmas time, through hearing from you, through hearing your word, through singing carols, through drama and presentation, may we see, know, and understand that Jesus Christ is God's Son and our Savior. That in our frailty and weakness, we might see that, know that, love Him, and follow Him. So help us, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. And those down at the front who have been sitting waiting nervously, Simeon the music.
This is the ancient city of Jerusalem, 2,000 years ago. In front is the large open courtyard of the temple, a place that's always busy. It used to be a happy place where people would come to celebrate and pray to God. But as you can see, no one is celebrating today. Since Herod became ruler, times have been hard. All Herod's interested in is money and fame. Right now, he's putting together a list of everyone in the country so he can make sure they're paying their taxes. People are becoming poorer and poorer, and many are forced to beg on the streets. There was at least one person in Jerusalem who wasn't afraid of Herod and his soldiers. His name was Simeon, a wise and kind old man. Years before, God had given Simeon a very special promise. God was sending a king to set them free, and despite the fact Simeon was very old, he wouldn't die before he'd seen him.
Just free.
sleep outside under the night sky.
Next.
the city, Simeon was working quietly when he heard someone calling him.
Simeon! Simeon!
He couldn't see who it was, but someone was definitely calling his name. The voice told him to go to the temple. It was time for God's promise to come true. When Simeon arrived at the temple, he looked around. Nothing special was happening. There was just a poor young couple holding a baby. Simeon offered to give thanks to God for the child. He took the baby in his arms. All of a sudden, he knew that this baby was very, very special. He was holding the king God had sent to set them free. Jesus, the Savior. Once again, there was celebration in the Temple of Jerusalem. God's promise had come true.
And because that was the case, I'd actually soaked all the chocolate off these because they're actually chocolate peanuts. At which point the minister felt in a sick, as one might imagine. But it struck me that Christmas is a wee bit like that at times. We like the kind of chocolate, sugary coating. We like sometimes the kind of nice bits. And yet if we soak off, as it were, the outside chocolate coating, at the heart there's something much more worthwhile. At the time of Jesus' birth, it's quite evident, not only from the New Testament, but from quite a number of documents that were around at the time, that the Jews had a particular understanding, a particular perspective of the kind of Messiah that they expected to come. They expected some kind of latter-day version of King David, somebody with a crown on his head and then a great white charger, as it were. Says in his gospel that she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them at the inn. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. The other day, trying to find somewhere to stay, but there was a wee gang of ministers trying to find somewhere for Christmas lunch, and ministers being ministers, we hadn't booked anywhere. We therefore went into one location and got ourselves sat down, and we got our soft drinks and so on, and we were sitting there waiting, and we had taken ages over who was getting what and who sorted out the admin and all the rest, and somebody eventually got to the counter, and then they said, "We can't couldn't even take your order for an hour. Christmas, we recognize that for many of us it is indeed a time of celebration, a time of happiness, a time of family gatherings, and so we say thank you for that. But Father, we come to you and we recognize that for some, and for some dear souls even this morning, they are waking up to disaster, or they have recently encountered disaster. We think this morning especially, dear Father, of these dear folks in Venezuela and in Caracas, where so many have seen their homes and in some cases their loved ones swept away with a great torrent of flood. Something that for most of us we cannot begin to comprehend, something that for most of us is just another item in the news that looks rather dramatic. So Father, we pray, dear Lord, we pray for those engaged in relief work, that you would speed their efforts. We pray most especially, but not exclusively, but especially for those Christian agencies, for Tear Fund and Christian Aid, for our friends at BMS, the Baptist Missionary Society, for the relief fund that will need to be called upon yet again after yet another disaster. And so Father, we pray, Lord, for Christian folks, that in the midst of that darkness and difficulty, they would be beacons of light in the midst of a dark world. And for dear folks who struggle to understand what all of this might mean and who wrestle with the reality of perhaps having lost a loved one, for many having lost their homes and perhaps the means of their livelihood, we pray, dear Lord, that in the midst of grief, they may turn to the one who is the author of life and a new find comfort. We pray this morning, Father, for members, friends of the congregation here who are unwell at this time. We pray for folks who would love to be with us this morning, but this opportunity to give and pray, dear Lord, that these gifts would be used, that the good news that Jesus has come to be with us would be spread near and far. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Challenge our preconceptions of the nativity scene, that we like somehow to sanitize and tart up, as it were. But in very reality, Christ had his first hours next to the animals in the fire. And yet he is the one who is our Redeemer, the one who come to make the one to whom all are called to recognize as Lord and Savior. One of the great difficulties, as I will say time and again, with our understanding of sin, is that we think of sin only as the big and horrible things of murder and robbery and so on, and to be sure such things are sin. But in the eyes of a perfectly holy God, anything which either falls short, like aiming at a target and just missing it a bit, or anything which transgresses a line, is sin. And in that context, then, as Paul tells us in his letter to the Romans, we all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. To be sure, the vast majority of us have not committed great or heinous crime. Some of us might have, but the majority of us have not. us today, we hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings, then will come to us. Abide with us, our Lord Emmanuel. And then, shortly, in our closing hymn, we will sing in the well-known carol, Hark the Herald Angels Sing, the line, born, let man no more may die. Born to give them second birth. Hark, the Herald Angels Sing, glory to the newborn King. Why then? What is this talk referred to in these hymns? Cast out our sin and enter in, be born in us today. What is this talk of second birth? Well, there was a man many years ago who had similar questions. He came and had a dialogue with Jesus. There was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night. Said, Rabbi, we know you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the miraculous signs you are doing if God were not with him. In reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth. No one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. How can a man be born when he is old? Nicodemus asked. Surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb to be born? I tell you the truth, Jesus answered. No one can enter the kingdom of God unless he is born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to Spirit. Later, then, Nicodemus says, how can this be? And at this point, then, John records for us in his account of the Gospel what is almost certainly the most famous verse in the Bible. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal. And so the Christ child came, lived, died. That much might seem unremarkable, but then rose again from the dead, fully God, fully man. Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forever. Will we then, this Christmas time, whether young or old, will we then say with conviction, Lord, cast out my sin, enter and be born in me today? This Christmas time, may we enjoy the parties. Festivities. May we enjoy the family gatherings and the meeting with friends. May we enjoy the exchanging of greetings and Christmas cards. May we enjoy the late night phone calls and all of that stuff to family abroad. And today, no doubt, our email messages at odd hours of the day. May we enjoy all of that. But beyond that, this Christmas time, may all of us see that the Christ who is at the heart of Christmas is Christ the Redeemer who is here, Christ who came to give. stood back a bit and looked and took a more panoramic view. At his side, you see, were some paints and brushes, and he picked them up. The man happened to be Edward Landseer, one of the most foremost painters of landscapes in Scotland. And he saw the stain and he looked at it and he said, I could make something out of that. And he took his paint and his brushes in a way that would give someone like me great wonder. And he started to etch and sketch and paint round the stains, and then you could begin to see a stag. And as you saw the stag, you saw the scenery of a Scottish hillside behind it, and all stood in wonder as something that at one moment was just a great stain and a blot became something quite beautiful. Jesus came that the mess that is sometimes our lives maybe made something beautiful by putting our faith in the babe who was born in Bethlehem. Let's join together in the closing song. Hark the herald angels sing. Mission Praise number 211. May you have a good and blessed Christmas. May you learn to know and love the Saviour if you don't already do so. And for now, we celebrate Mission Praise number 211. Let's stand to sing.
Special thanks to